We got a non-alcoholic one as well. What do you like, ma'am?
The greatest tragedy of so many lives we lose through suicide or as a result of depression are the more tragic for being treatable through talking and through intervention. So tonight the theme is connection. The theme is it takes a village to raise a child. It also takes a village to make a difference, and that's what we're doing tonight. So thank you so much for coming and making that difference. We really appreciate you being part of tonight.
The darkness falls, your heart will
lady just up the road said to me that she still carries in her heart something that she hasn't shared with almost anyone, and that is, she said that her brother died, his life was ended by his own hand. It's only now since she's seen the encouragement of people in our own community locally that she feels she's able to share that. She's been carrying it around with her. And so may the light of those who we remember today overcome the darkness of sorrow. And may God, however we understand him, who honours our journeys as well as our destinations, allow us to see more clearly those with whom we walk. May he who honours old questions as well as new answers walk with us. And may love and life I have the last word.
May it be you journey on to light the day. You walk a lonely road. Oh, how far you are from home.
Fuel and punishment of aspiration. The Enlightenment's airburst. Back when God made me, I had no script. It was better. For all the death, we also die unrehearsed.
Suicide and suicidal behaviour, it's the last taboo that we have to deal with. It's the last issue that we have to get out from under the carpet, and you're doing that here tonight. 25,000 Australians in the last decade have died from suicide, and these are largely preventable deaths. In our service in Melbourne last year, we had something like $1 million removed from our funding, and 8 or 9 young people died in the months following that. Our responses so far in Australia have been pretty ineffective and diffuse. In fact, the numbers of suicide are actually going up. So that tells you something. This is a major public health problem. We're not seeing the curve being bent at all. And, you know, the Mental Health Commission report has just reported to the Minister recently, and it contains very significant recommendations about how to tackle suicide on a regional basis. But I think they could come to this region and learn some lessons from you. We have to not just talk about the issue and be more open and get rid of all of these feelings of shame and guilt and the other things that go with it, and provide real support to the bereaved. But we have to do something to stop future deaths. We have to mobilise the community to actually take the actions that need to be taken to save lives.
Come away, leave it all far behind you.
People come along and say, hey, we've got to look after the well-being of our kids, and look, here's all these programs. And that's the problem. The approach to mental health is a program. And I really wanted to challenge this because I thought, you know what? We don't do that with many other things. You know, it's not a program. If you add more things to it, more things to the school day, you'd literally run out of time. 50% of teachers, even though they know the mental health of young people is vitally important, 50% of them don't have time to address it or think they don't have time to address it. Mental health of kids isn't an add-on in schools. It's actually core business. It's as important in schools as numeracy and literacy, because without mental health, you ain't going to read very well and you ain't going to add up very well. But the problem is, whilst teachers know this, teachers know that if we get the engagement and the well-being of kids right, outcomes will follow. There's a rhetoric around education at the moment that we need to improve outcomes at all costs because we're falling behind our Asian neighbours, or, God forbid, falling behind Finland. But unfortunately, we're pursuing outcomes now in schools at the expense of genuine engagement and well-being, not only of kids, but of staff. We need to stop that. And the way we stop that is by, as a community, telling our schools, telling our politicians that, you know what? We care more about our kids than we do about beating Finland. We know that school connectedness, the extent to which a kid feels that they belong at school, is an even stronger predictor of well-being and depression than even attachment to parents. Because they're spending so long at school compared to how much time they spend with parents.
Everything will be all right now, all right.
In 1989, when my brother suicided, since that point, many times over, I have a dream where I dream that he's here. And it is a great dream because I hug him and I talk to him, and it's
overwhelming. I'm a crier, but I think it's all right. And you know it's all right.
But if you loved me, why'd you leave me? Take my body, take my body. And all I want.
18 months later, as has been touched on, my father suicided. And he'd lost his job, low self-esteem. But I do distinctly remember saying to him that we need you. You know, we need both our parents. For my sister, there's my sister, and myself were left. And Dad took his life. And you get up and you put one foot in front of the other because you have to. You've got no other choice. To be honest, did I have any faith in the mental health system? No. How could I? Twice. We'd been through that twice. I just prayed that things would turn out okay, and they didn't. But things have changed, and things are changing. That said, we've got a long way to go.
Why'd you leave me? Take my back. Take my body, and all I want.
So now, through experience, do I believe that there are health professionals out there that can help? Absolutely there are. But we need more of them, and we need more services. And I think it is up to us, and I applaud this community. It might not be your direct family, but it might be the neighbours, or it might be your sister's family, or you might know of somebody within a sporting community you're involved with. It's up to us to link hands, if you like, and get them through this really difficult period in their life. And for a lot of people, this struggle can be ongoing. We've got to continue to help and get them through this. And I just think what this community is doing is incredible. If you haven't jumped online to the various organizations or websites that we have discussed here tonight, please do it, and please go away tonight and talk about tonight with somebody that you know is not here. Because we are making a difference. We have to continue to make a difference. This perceived stigma about mental health is absurd. It's stupid. We are working towards a time when there will be no stigma. We have to talk about mental health issues. Number one, we have to communicate. Please, everybody, talk and listen. You.
It's been really heartening to see the instantaneous recognition that this event is getting amongst this community, but also beyond the community, through the likes of Patrick spreading the message, but others as well. It can be on a very small scale, it can be as grand as this, but why not use the winter solstice as an opportunity to get to talk about mental health and doing making a difference. It is all our hope, and I hope it's yours too, that this actually becomes something on a grander scale. It actually becomes, in a lot of other communities, in a lot of other households, it's just an observation, or an observance is the better word. It's about remembering, and it's about talking. As Brad said, talking makes the biggest difference, communicating.